first, and then after that we are going to be covering the selection as per mechanical data as well, right? So if you need to select servo actuators for your robotics project, how would you select that and which software would you use, right? So going back to the servo literature which we were talking about, right? So I'm going to go to a specific part, okay? Right, so when we were talking about encoders, I also explained that our current servo system also has an encoder at the back of it, right? So we have an encoder here, right? And what is actually going to happen is that this encoder feedback is either going to come to the drive or the controller, one of the two. Okay, so that is how we are going to have a closed loop system, or at least a semi closed loop system. Okay. So these encoder signals are actually going to be coming to us in the form of pulses. Okay. So we are going to be actually counting these pulses, and by counting the pulses, we'll get a certain frequency, right? So that is just about the encoder point of view, right? Now we'll go straight into the servo part of it. Okay, so we are going to actually be talking about some programming aspect of servo, especially when you are going to be programming from a pulse based device. Okay, so I know a lot of people actually do basics of robotics from Arduino, right? And in Arduino we are using PWM. So I'm just going to be taking a brief on difference between PWM, PTO, why we use PTO in the industry, and how I will show you a live example of how we are going to be programming using PTO, right? Great. So we'll start off with the servo control, okay? And right, so we are going to be looking at a particular instruction, and with the help of this instruction, we'll also understand how we can calculate the number of pulses and also the speed at which the servo is going to run. So in order to do this I'm actually going to open up WordPad or something, so that we can actually just have a little visual idea of what we are talking about. Okay, so whenever we look at a servo system, especially when we are looking at a servo system in robotics, okay, we are very interested in this concept of PPR, okay? And this PPR is what we call as pulses per revolution, okay? So this is the amount of pulses I will require to give the servo per revolution, okay? So exactly how are we actually controlling the servo? That again, I will use Paint, I think, for that, to just give a little bit demonstration, right? So we are actually going to be giving pulses to the servo, right? So I have already explained that we have two outputs, okay? So we have a Y0 output, right? This is one output of my PLC, which will be connected to the servo. And this Y0 is going to be giving out. Pulses like this. This is what the pulses are going to look like. I'll just draw it quickly. And we'll draw a line here just to show the continuous. And we will erase this part, right? So this is actually what your pulses over time is going to look like, right? This is what is going to be outputted by your PLC. Now, if you notice, I have drawn these approximately the same duty cycle, okay? And there is a reason for this, is because in PTO, which is the technology we are using, right? So I'm going to write PTO as well. This technology is having duty cycle of equal to each other, right? So each pulse duty cycle is going to be same, right? Now this is different from your PWM, right? So in PWM is generally what your is used in Arduino based control, which is your pulse width modulation, right? So what in pulse width modulation, you are actually changing the duty cycle, right? So you are going to have based on your duty cycle and your width of pulse, that is going to define your speed, and also number of pulses will define the position, right? So this is what a pulse width modulation generally will look like, something like this, right? Where you know, all your pulses will be of different width, right? But this is generally this is not what we are doing in the industry, right? We are doing we are using something called as PTO, right? And so the reason for this is mainly because of accuracy reasons. Okay, so in PWM you will generally not get as much accuracy as you would get in a PTO based system, which is a pulse train output based system, right? So just to make it very simple for everyone, in a PTO based system, we are going to be outputting certain pulses from our output, our designated output, right? And it will always work in a pair. Okay, so I will ask the attendees also to answer the question of why do we require a pair, okay, of outputs. Okay, why do we need a pair to control a servo, right? So you, after I explain this, maybe we can ask that question. So we have the outputs in a pair, so that means to run one servo drive you will require two outputs, right? You'll require a Y0 and you'll require a Y1. Now, why we use this Y1, that you will answer me, right? Tell me what is missing, right? After we explain the whole thing. So if everyone can notice, we have, you know, we have a certain amount of pulses here. So we have here one pulse, we have a second pulse here, and we have third pulse here, right? So we are going to be going from 0 volts to 24 volts and come back down with a constant duty cycle, and that becomes one pulse of mine, right? So coming back to PPR, it's PPR is pulses per revolution, right? So this is the amount of pulses which I will require to give from my controller for my servo to rotate one revolution, right? That means one whole 360 degrees, right? This is how we are calculating it, right? So generally PPR is something that has to be set from the servo drive. Okay, so I will just give you now when we talk about Schneider Electric and many other servos. Okay, there are many groups of these servos who use the same kind of technique. They use a numerator denominator type thing. Okay, so they actually have some particular parameters. So I will show you. If I go to parameter P144. So I'm just increasing this number here. You can see I'm changing the number. And these servos all have different parameters, obviously. So if I look at this, I see a value of 640. And if I go to 45, I see a value of 1. Okay. So actually, the formula for these servo drives is a very simple formula. They have, it is the base encoder counts multiplied by P145 divided by P144, okay, where your P145 is actually your numerator and your P144 is your denominator. Okay, this is used, we call this as a gearing, okay? We call this as a gearing, and we can use this in order to change the pulses per revolution of my servo, right? So over here, my base encoder PPR is going to be 12,80,000, okay? that is fixed inside the servo, and I'm going to multiply by the P145 value, which is currently, I showed you all, was set to 1, right? So I'll just go here and you can see it is set to 1, right? And I'm going to divide this by P144. And if I had actually seen that value, it is set at C640. Now this is, I have set obviously these parameters. And if I set this to 640 here, right? So if you actually calculate this, 1,280,000 divided by 640 is going to give you 2,000 pulses, okay? This is what is going to be your PPM, right? What does this actually mean for us as programmers, right? As a programmer, it means that if I give 2,000 of these pulses from Y0 on and off, then this servo is going to rotate one revolution. Okay, that is what it's going to mean, right? So this is very, very important even when you're programming robots to understand the PPR. Okay, so right now it is set at 2,000, right? Now, why have I not, what is the significance of this PPR basically, right? What is the significance? Why do we set this PPR? And this PPR is set because we need to, we need to understand that we are getting a resolution from this, right? So what is resolution? Resolution is the smallest unit you will be able to move your servo, right? So if I actually look at this smallest unit, okay, so if I divide, everyone knows that servos rotate 360 degrees, right? So if I have to actually figure out the smallest unit with 2000 PPR, I will take 360 divide by 2000, right? Because I know that 2000 pulses equal to one revolution, 360 degrees is one revolution. So that means my accuracy, how many degrees I can be accurate, is 360 divided by 2000, which has come to 0.18 degrees, right? So right now for 2000, this corresponds to 0.18 degrees resolution, okay? This is 0.18 degrees resolution, right? And this is very important to us, right? In robotics, right? Because in robots, we want to know what is the minimum amount of angle I can give to get a precise movement, right? Now, in case I have an application, very specific medical application, let's say, and this 0.18 degrees is too much for me. I want more accuracy, right? In that case, I will have to increase this PPR, okay? So if I increase the PPR to, let's say, 10,000, okay, that would then correspond with the same formula, that would correspond to 0.036 degrees of resolution. That means I can move that servo shaft by 0.036 degrees, okay, that much of accuracy. As you increase this PPR, you are going to get better resolution. Now, definitely in everyone's head, there will be this also. One question mark will come is that why should I not increase the resolution, the PPR to full? I want maximum resolution, right? The problem happens when you are using lower end controllers, okay? Like, let's say we are using a PLC to output pulses, or we're using an Arduino or something like that. So generally these controllers have a limit on the frequency, okay? So it is a frequency limit, right? Which right now in my controller is set to 100 kilohertz, right? So I have a limit of 100 kilohertz, which means that I have a limit of 100,000 pulses per second. Okay, I have a limit of 100,000 pulses per second, right? So you might think that I will not cross this, but I will 101% cross this, okay? So I will show you how I will cross this 100,000 pulses per second. So we are going to be using this PTO, okay? PTO will be used, and I'm going to show you the first example of how we are going to be practically doing this, okay? So let me actually show you my shaft. So you can see that my shaft, have put some green stickers here so that it is very visible. There is also a notch, but that is not very visible to some people. So I put these green stickers so that you all will understand when it is going one revolution, right? So let me go to my programming window now, and let's see how we can run the first instruction, right? So the first instruction which I'm going to run is something called as DPLSY, which is the this particular PLC is pulse output instruction. Okay, so I am going to be giving two inputs to this block. Okay, and like I said, I wanted to take very basics of programming so that everyone understands what is happening, right? So I have taken a single X4 contact, right, which is this switch right here, and this is going to start this pulse output block, right? And this the objective of this pulse output block is to actually move this servo, right? I have still not discussed one thing, which is basically what is this Y1 used for, right? So now when we have to control this servo, I told you there are two things which we need to achieve. We need to figure out the position which I'm going to move this servo, and I need to figure out the speed at which I'm going to move this servo, right? There are two things I need to figure out. So if I need to calculate this position and I need to calculate this speed, okay, the position is simply going to be the number of pulses I'm giving, right? So I know that 2000 PPR is equal to one revolution is equal to 360 degrees. That means I can get for one pulse is equal to 0.18 degrees. That means every pulse I give, I'm going to move forward 0.18 degrees. Okay. So this is the whole calculation. So your position is equal to number of pulses which I'm going to give, right? Your position is going to be equal to the number of pulses I'm going to give, right? So then what is going to be the speed, right? If I want to control speed. So the speed is going to be the frequency at which I give these pulses, right? So I am giving a set number of pulses. Let's say I'm giving 100 pulses per second, and that 100 pulses per second becomes my frequency of 100 hertz, right? So I'll be giving 100 pulses per second, right? So the number of pulses is going to determine my position, and how fast I give those pulses is going to determine the speed or the velocity, right? So let us go back to our IDE, and we are going to just see the instruction first, right? So this instruction has two inputs. So we can see that there are two inputs, one S1 and one S2, right? So we need to basically change some values over here, right? And we have one output device over here, which is our Y0, okay? So the question is, I had asked one question previously, is that if I'm able to control, the number of pulses, which is my position, right? That means this is going to rotate, right? This is going to rotate. I can set how much it's going to rotate and how fast it's going to rotate. What is the one thing which I still cannot control? Just let me know in the comments. Okay. If anyone gets this, amazing. Okay. So there is one thing I still cannot control. I'll keep that as the 5 minutes. I will tell you why. Okay. What I cannot control. Right. And something very obvious, right? It is something very obvious that I cannot control till now. So I can only, I'm able to control the position. I'm able to control the speed at which I this, and just think of it very practically, right? Okay. So coming back to the programming part, right? The programming part, we have S1 is the pulse output frequency. So this is your speed basically. And S2 is the number of pulses, right? So number of pulses is very straightforward. Okay. Your number of pulses is going to be correlated with your PPR. Okay. So if you give, if you set a PPR of 2000, okay. So that means if you give number of pulses is 2000, it is going to rotate one full revolution. Very simple, right? What is important to us is the speed. How do we calculate the speed, right? And this is something which in robotics, we work in counts per second or pulses per second. Okay. We never work, or maybe maximum degrees per second, right? So we need to understand how to work in these units, right? So just imagine that this is connected to a robotic joint, and we are going to be rotating this now, right? And we need to give it some particular speed, right? So this pulse output frequency has to be calculated now. Okay, so let's do a very quick calculation, right, of how we can do this. So I know that I know that my PPR is currently set to 2000, right? My PPR is currently set to 2000 pulses, right? Now supposing I give a frequency of, let's say, 2000 pulses per second, right? So now observe, I'm giving 2000 pulses per second, right? 2000 pulses per second. Now I know that 2000 pulses is equal to one rotation, right? So if I give 2000 pulses per second, that means I am giving 60 rotations, right? I hope everyone has followed, because there are 60 seconds in a minute, right? So I'm giving 2000 pulses per second. That means I'm getting 60 rotations. That means that if I set my frequency equal to PPR, right, which is currently at 2000, right? That means my rotations per second is going to be 60. Does this sound familiar, this word? This is 2000 pulses per second. If I give it 60 times, that becomes per minute, and we have RPM. Okay, so this is the unit which everyone knows of speed, which is basically RPM. So if I give a frequency of 2000, I am going to get a 60 RPM output. Okay, so let me actually show you this. Okay, we'll try to do this now. 60 RPM is a little fast, it will not be able to be visually seen. So we are going to maybe give 6 RPM. So instead of giving 2000 frequency, I will give 200 frequency, divide by 10. Okay, so we'll see how that works. So this is the frequency. So I said instead of 2000, we'll give 200, which is going to correspond to my 6 RPM. Okay, and this is my position, which is I wanted only one revolution. So I'm going to give this as 2000, right? So let me just compile this and download this and see what is going to happen. Okay, so let me start with this. I'm going to be putting on this contact, and this is going to start the instruction. So we are going to see the speed in RPM over here, and we are going to see the rotation over here. Okay, so let's just start this, and we can see 6.0 RPM is given here, and this is going to rotate and come straight back to where we have started, which is around here, right? Right, so this is where we had started, right? If I want to run this again, you can run, and it will again stop around that same point. Okay, so this is how we are rotating the servo and giving the pulses per second. Now obviously this is not fun, we need to increase the speed. Okay, so in order to increase the speed, I will increase this to 60 RPM first. Okay, let me change this to 2000. So as I said in the calculation, if I had 2000 pulses, I'm giving 2000 pulses per second now, which means that I'm giving 60 rotations per minute, which makes it a 60 RPM frequency, right? So 2000 is equal to 60 RPM. And this is one revolution. Instead of one revolution, let us go for 10 revolutions, right? So one revolution is 2000. We are going to go for 10 revolutions, which is 20,000. Right, so let's do that, and let me update this program. And let us run this instruction. So this is going to run at 60 RPM, 10 revolutions. Right, so this is pulse train output, right? This is pulse train output, which is working right now. And it has stopped at that exact same position. Now, this is very important, right? That it stops at that exact same position, right? And that is why we are able to get very good accuracy with robots, industrial robots, right? It's because of this repeatability of the servo drive and servo motor, which we are able to get, right? So let me turn this off, and let us again now push the speed a little bit further, okay? So let me say that I have 20,000, which is going to be 600 RPM now, and again update this. So same amount of revolutions, but we are now completing this in 600 RPM, right? So That's 10 revolutions right there. Okay. So it obviously happens very fast. As you can see, it's very, very quick. Right. Right. And but that is not the max, the max speed at which we can run this servo motor, right? The max speed rated of this motor is actually, you will, if you need to find out, you will actually find out by reading the nameplate. Okay, so if you actually go closer, you, I just want to give an idea of how you figure these things out, right? So it's not very visible, but I will try to show it. You will see the data of 200 watt. You will also see the 3000 U per minute, which is basically your RPM. So this motor is rated at 3000 RPM. Okay. So one more important thing when we talk about selection of servos is that we need two main parameters. Those is your rated RPM, which I just showed you, which was 3000, and your rated torque. Okay, nominal torque or rated torque. This is the two important things which we need to show. So I had talked about there is going to be a limit of 100,000 pulses per second. Right now, I will show you now why we are crossing it. Right. So already now in here, we are giving 20,000 pulses per second. Right. So the question which I didn't answer yet was that why not increase the PPR to very high value? Right. So understand one thing. Right. So right now we are running this at 2000 PPR, which means that I require 2000 pulses per second to get 60 RPM, right? Supposing I have a PPR of 10,000. So then I need 10,000 pulses per second to get that same 60 RPM, right? Because my resolution has increased now, right? So what will happen after a certain point? Okay. So if I have 10,000 pulses per second for 60 RPM, right? So I'll just write it. So if I have 10,000 pulses per second for 60 RPM, then if I need 600 RPM, okay, I will require one more zero here, which will be pulses per second, and this will be my 600 RPM. Now what is going to happen is that this is my max pulses per second as per my PLC, right? I cannot go beyond this, right? So as soon as I cross 100,000 pulses per second, I will not be able to achieve higher than 600 RPM if my PPR is 10,000, right? Now, in my case, what is happening is that if I have 2000 pulses per second, I'm getting 60 RPM. So if I have 100,000 pulses per second, this is coming to 3000 RPM. You all can calculate this. Okay, it is coming to 3, just simple cross multiplication. Okay, if this is X, right? So this would be X pulses per second, right? And we have a target of 3000 RPM, which we want. So it actually comes out to 100,000 pulses per second. So this is, it is a trade-off of getting accuracy versus getting your desired speed, right? Now, there are some certain motion controllers which can run your frequency at 4 megahertz. Okay, so instead of 100,000, you have 4 lakh pulses per second allowed, right? So those are on higher level robotics which are used, right? We will be using those for higher level robotics, but this currently, I told you, this device has a limitation. So always when you are programming, whether you're using an Arduino or a Raspberry Pi, or you're using a PLC or whatever you're using, make sure that you understand what is the pulse limit, right? Over here, the pulse limit is 100,000 pulses. Okay, so we have programmed the servo, right? And again, I'm showing you. So now I think everyone would like to see the 100,000 pulses, maximum 3000 RPM, right? Running the servo at full speed, right? So if I have to do that, I will have to put 100,000 pulses here, right? So this is 1 lakh pulses, basically 100,000. And in my position, I have 10, right? Let's set this to 100 revolutions. Okay, so I want to go 100 revolutions of my servo and at a speed of 3000 RPM. Okay, so I just want to demonstrate the repeatability and accuracy of a servo using this example, right? So right now, obviously, when there is no load connected, definitely it will be absolutely perfect. Okay. So if you look here, we can see that there is no load connected on this. So that is why you're going to get an absolutely perfect position, right? But anyway, we will just run this instruction and see. So if I put a switch on, this is going to run at 3000 RPM, 100 revolutions. Let's see how much time it takes to reach that, okay? And that's done, okay? So that was 100 times the servo has gone 360 degrees, okay? Full one revolution, right? 100 times. And it has completed in just 2-3 seconds, right? And you can see that the servo RPM is being displayed over here, right? So if I just run this again, you will see that 3000 RPM and it stops over here, right? So now you will probably, if you all can hear my background noise, you all will hear the slight click sound of when it is stopping. It is because we are stopping at a very high speed, okay? So you will see a sort of click sound of the servo because it has to stop it at exactly this position which I have set, right? So this is the repeatability of servos, right? This is the power of servos being extremely accurate, right, for your robotic applications, right? So I have still not got an answer for that question. So I'm going to tell you the answer. The answer to that question is very simple, is that I have told you that you are going to go to a particular position and you can get a correct speed, which we calculated just now. But the question is that the direction, how will you know which direction the servo is going to rotate, right? That is the fundamental thing, whether it's going to go in forward, clockwise or anti-clockwise. That is the most important thing. So because of that, we require a second output, right? Which is why we use this Y1 output. Now, Y1 is going to be very simple. It's either going to be off or it is going to be on. Okay, so if it is off, it is going to be the default direction. If it is on, it is going to switch the direction. So this is how we actually switch direction. So when this command is given together. Okay, this command and this command is going to be given together, Y0 and Y1, right? So while Y0 is giving out pulses at a particular frequency, this Y1 is either going to be on or off, right? Now, if you notice very carefully, okay, those who have been paying attention to the block, you will see that in the output side of the block, there is only Y0. There is no Y1, which means that this particular instruction can only run in a particular direction. Okay, we cannot reverse in this particular instruction. So in order to actually change that direction, okay, we will need to use something called as DDRBI, okay, which is another instruction. Okay, so using this instruction, you can actually change the rotational direction as well. Okay, so we are not going to be looking at this. It is just going forward and reverse. But just for your knowledge, there is an instruction like that. Now, sometimes what happens is that when we are running a servo, even in robotics, right, we need to actually understand how our speed curve is going to be going. So when I run a servo, if you notice, this is currently the behavior, okay? So if I actually have, let me just erase this completely or just take a new, I guess, right? So if I have a graph of X to Y, which is my speed is to time, right? I have a graph of speed is to time. What is going to happen is that my servo is going to start from this particular position, right? So this is my time. Okay, I'll just write it over here. This is my time, and this can be my y-axis is my speed, right? So what is actually happening when I was running this at 3000 RPM, if you notice, it was something like this, right? This was going very fast to 3000 RPM, right? And it was achieving that speed, and then we were running it like this at some constant, and then it had to stop at some particular position, right? So it had to immediately decelerate and stop here. Okay, this shape is called as a trapezoidal shape, right? This is a trapezoid, and we call this as a trapezoidal curve. Okay, Now, the problem with this trapezoidal curve is that there is going to be some variation at this point, right? Why? Because when I'm talking, when there is load connected, right? There's going to be a variation at this point and there's going to be a variation at this point. Why is there variation? Because it is very obvious that these are, it is very obvious is because these are sudden change in direction or sudden change in speed of movement, right? And whenever that happens, when there is a load connected, there is always a danger of slippage or something like that, right? So we have to be very careful which application we are using a trapezoid. In order to actually smoothen this, what we can do is actually round these corners, okay? So if we actually round these corners, we can actually achieve some level of smoothness, right? So if I just take, this. So I can round this like this, right? Just take a thick. Yeah, I can round it like this. So this will give me a smoother response, right? So some modern PLCs and all motion controllers will have this kind of functionality where you can change the edges of your curve, right? Now, what if we don't want to reach this? So this is my 3000 RPM, right? This is my 3000, right? So what if I don't want to immediately reach this 3000, right? I want to have a ramp, right? So instead of having this, right, I want to have a ramp where I will maybe, let's say, have a graph like this, right? Let me just draw it correctly. Right, so we have this ramp, and supposing I want to have a ramp like, let's say this, it will go aram se to 3000. It will take maybe, 2 seconds, 3 seconds to reach, and then it will achieve that speed of 3000 RPM. And then again, I don't want it to immediately stop, right? We saw that clicking noise which was coming, like that tuck kind of click noise which was coming. We don't want that, right? We want a smooth stop. So we'll be able to smoothly stop, right? So we want this kind of curve rather than a jerk curve. So in order to do that, we require to use a different instruction, right? And that instruction is called as a pulse ramp, okay? It's called as a pulse ramp instruction, where as the name suggests, we are going to be using a ramp. Now, what does the ramp look like? This is a ramp, right? This is what I call as ramping up my speed and ramping down my speed, right? So if I'm going to be using a ramp, here now I have, in the previous instruction, I just had two things to set. Here I have three, okay? So I will just change the instruction quickly and you will see that the ramp is, the instruction will also change. So I change it to DPLSR, right? This is the new instruction. And here I have three things, right? So I need to set this to Y0 again. I have the first one is my pulse output frequency. Again, that is my speed. So let's keep the speed to 3000 RPM itself. Then we have this position, which is 100. And now we also have one more variable which we can set, which is the acceleration and deceleration in milliseconds. Okay, so now some controllers will give you this in milliseconds. Some of them will give you in counts per second square or pulses per second square. Okay, so it is usually units per second square basically, but here they have given you the luxury of having it in milliseconds, right? Because it is understandable by us. So if I want to set it in milliseconds, let's say I want a 3 seconds ramp. Okay, so I will set 3000 milliseconds, right? And the same is going to be set for deceleration as well. So let me download this and show you the behavior. Okay, this is going to be a smoother movement. Okay, so if you are ever moving something like a robot in a fast pattern, we will definitely want to use a ramp up and ramp down. Okay. Okay, so let's look at this now, and you will notice now, first when I was pressing the switch, it was going straight to 3000 RPM. Now you will see over a period of 3 seconds, it's going to reach 3000 RPM, and then it is also not going to stop immediately with a click. Okay, it is going to, over a period of 3 seconds, it is going to decelerate. Okay, so observe this very carefully, and we'll start this. you can see that it's slowly increasing to 3000 RPM. Yes, so it is already finished actually. So we will actually need to increase the number of steps. Okay. So why it is not reaching 3000 RPM? It is because the number of steps is less. Okay, so we'll have to definitely increase this. Instead of 100, we'll have to set maybe 300 or 400 or something like that, right? So we'll set this to double, maybe that would be better. So we'll get a period of time where it will stay to 3000 RPM, right? So currently what is happening, if you notice, it is basically happening like this, right? The curve is happening. I'll just change the color. The curve is happening like this. This is what is happening currently, just for an understanding, right? I'm not achieving my target speed, which is 3000 here, right? This is my 3000 on top. It is because the pulses are, this is taking mandatory 3 seconds. This is taking mandatory 3 seconds. This is why it has gotten stuck now, right? So we want this kind of curve. So I have updated, go back to running, right? So let me try running this now. And I think it hasn't downloaded. Just do it again. So now when we run this servo, we will see that it will take 3 seconds to reach 3000 RPM. You can see that it's increasing. Now it has achieved the speed, which we are at the top of the curve, and now it is slowly going to decelerate, right? So obviously this 3 seconds is a lot for this kind of movement. We will have to probably keep it like 1 second or something would be the correct amount, right? Still not going to jerk, right? So if I, even if I set this to 1 second, which is 1000 milliseconds, still it is not going to jerk basically, right? It is not going to actually stop with a loss of position or something like that, right? Right, so we are downloading this and let's get back. And now it is less acceleration deceleration, but you can still see that it is stopping over one period of 1 second, right? So going to achieve the 3000 at the top of the trapezoid and then slowly decelerate, right? So 1 second is enough for this application, right? This is especially useful in gantry robots. Okay, so in gantry robots you do not want to stop with a very heavy mechanism. You do not want to stop immediately. You definitely want to give it a curve, right? So I hope that this is understood by everyone, right? Okay. So this is all about your programming of servo motors. I hope that you enjoyed the practical session. Just to give you an exposure of the working of how we program servos in the industry, even in robotics as well, right? Now there are certain things that we need to understand, after programming, is that when we go from PLCs to servo drives, PLCs to motion controllers, we go into a domain called as motion engineering. Okay, and I am actually a motion engineer. That is what my work is. And what we as motion engineers do is actually decide the profile movement of servos, right? So if we have an palletizer robot or a SCADA robot or Delta robot or a pick and place application, even normal pharmaceutical machines, FMCG machines, all that, all these machines currently use motion engineering, right? So what we actually do is that we use something called as ECAM design, or we use something called as gearing in order to change the profile. So we talked about the speed profile, right? this is the speed profile, and we can see this is a trapezoid. Now, if I wanted to actually, get a really good profile, I could actually get a sine curve, okay? So if I get a sine curve, right, I'll be able to get a fantastic response of my servo, okay? And you will actually see a lot of the movements in robots and robotics is actually a sine movement, okay? It is not a trapezoidal movement. I'm only talking about the speed now, right? It might be going a little bit too deep into it, but when we are talking about a trapezoid movement versus a speed movement, I'm talking only about the speed, right? So if you notice, in the, there is no point here where it is a abrupt change in speed, unlike here where you can see there is an abrupt change in speed. So you will not see a jerk while you're moving your arm or your robot or your machine, right? So motion engineering is the study of that, okay? And study and programming of that, okay? So there are some other functions also in motion controllers which are very, very useful for robotics, okay? And I wanted to just share some of that, okay? So one of the most important, I would say, is something which we call as interpolation, okay? And interpolation is something which you mandatory have to do in robotics. There is no choice about it. And we have different types of interpolation. And I'm very sure that most people know at least the concept of linear interpolation. But still, if that concept is not clear, I'm here to explain it. So what does interpolation actually mean? Is interpolation, I would say my definition would be reaching a target position in the least amount of distance, okay? So you are actually, let's look at something very simple like a linear interpolation, okay? Linear interpolation. Let's say I want to move, I have an XY gantry, okay? I hope everyone knows what a gantry is. There is an X and a Y, and I want to move it. There is no Z now, right? So it is just going to be moving X and Y, right? So I have that whole XY coordinate with me. And I have a target point, right? So you can see, let's say I have this, I have a target point here, right? So this is my target point. I want to move from X00, X as in 0, 0, which is my Y, X and Y coordinate, to some target position, right? So in order to do this, I will set some instruction. And if I have non-interpolation, a normal movement, what is going to happen is that the system does not understand X and Y together, right? It is only going to take this movement of X first, and then it is going to go to Y, right? So it will say move X to this point and then move Y to this point, which is, as you can tell, it is a very tedious process, right? Now, the shortest possible path would be the resultant, right? So this is the resultant from year to year. This is the blue line is the resultant. And that is actually the path which is has to be followed by my servos, right? So my servo X will be moving at the same time as Y in such a way that I follow this blue line, which is my resultant path, right? That is called as interpolation. Okay, I hope everyone, you all have understood what simple interpolation is, right? Now, there are some cases in which we need to move in arcs, okay? This is very common in robotic arc welding, okay? When we have to, or robotic welding in general, where we need to actually weld arcs, right? We don't have a straight line to weld. We have to weld around an arc. So for that, you will definitely need a radius, okay? And we use something called as circular interpolation, okay? So circular interpolation can be used to actually move along the circumference of a circuit, okay? And you'll need the radius for that, right? So the calculation for that is all very different. This is now interpolation only. We are talking about X and Y till now, right? When we have two axes, we have interpolations which are also more advanced, okay? So now when we have an interpolation where we have a helical movement, we also have something called as helical interpolation, right? So helical is like almost like a spring movement, right? So you're going to have your X and Y moving in circular, and you're also going to have a Z also. So it becomes a helix, okay? So we have something called as helical interpolation. right? And that is very much used in the tools industry. So you can, I'm sure many of you all have seen the YouTube videos of this, where, you know, metal is cut, corners are cut in circular interpolation and stuff. So if we want to make something like a borehole, or we want to make maybe something like a spring, we definitely need helical interpolation. Okay. Now, helical interpolation, as obviously it's not going to be just X and Y, there's going to be a Z component also added, because you are also moving down or up, right? So you're going to have a Z component to it. And the last part, which I would talk about for interpolation, is your spherical interpolation. Okay. So now in a spherical interpolation, what happens is that instead of moving along a fixed 2D arc, okay, you need to actually move across a radius as well, right? So it's just not moving a simple arc. You also want to move the arc with an angle as well, right? Again, that is a very complicated mathematics. You all can go through it if it is interesting to you. But helical interpolation functions are inbuilt in most motion controllers, right? So either you will directly get the function, you just have to put the relevant points, right? So again, spherical interpolation will have X, Y, and Z components. Okay. Right. So yes, I think what I will do now is, I think we have completed the servo point of view. I think the only thing left now is the selection part, which is very, very important from a mechanical mechatronics point of view, right? And this is the part which I feel that a lot of people get wrong. Okay. Many people get stuck only in selection. Okay. Which servo to select, which one to buy, what is the rating, but what, how much I will require. Okay. There is no, to teach this for every single robot is impossible. Okay. I will just show you an example of a very simple palletizer robot. Okay. And I will show you that if you need to actually calculate for this, how would you do it? Okay. So let's take this example. Okay. For selection, right? So I'm going to be actually selecting my rating of this particular machine, right? And what do I have to select? I have to select the rating of the motor, right? Now, unlike conventional industry where we used to use AC motors, okay, it is now become impossible for us to wrongly select servos because how expensive servos are, right? So generally in induction motors, you will see that there is maybe sometimes no price difference between a 1 HP and a 1.5 HP or something, right? It's not that much of a difference. In servo, as you go 400 watts to 750 watts to 1 kilowatt to 1.5 kilowatt, which is basically the standard wattage you get, you're going to see the price increase exponentially. Okay. So definitely, if you do a wrong selection in for your application or your robot, you are going to be ending up paying a lot more than what you would, right? Let's use this very simple example. Now, in this example, I first need to understand what is the mechanics used over here, right? So I know right now that the mechanics is a ball screw type. Okay, so ball screws are used very commonly in the industry. Those from mechanical background will definitely know about this. Those who are electrical electronics, just understand that it is a screw upon which we are going to be mounting our load. Okay, so we'll be able to move some object. Now, if this screw rotates, this will move forward. And if it rotates in the reverse direction, it will move reverse. That is how a ball screw works. So this ball screw is actually located over here. Okay, so X and Y, and here also one ball screw will be located, and there'll be one on the Z as well, right? So by just rotating the servo, we are able to move it side to side, up to down, and X, Y, Z basically, right? Now, the important thing is how to select the servo from this, right? If you will definitely require some mechanical data, okay? So once you have that mechanical data, we will see what we'll require. Let's go to my selection software. So there are many, many brands which have selection software. The one which I like to use is by Panasonic. Okay. It doesn't matter which brand of servo drive and servo motor you are using, because at the end of the day, it is going to be you know, it is going to be same standard which is going to be used. Okay, so we are actually some people generally have this question: is what do I mean by same standard? What I mean by same standard is that everyone, Schneider, Mitsubishi, Allen Bradley, Rockwell, Siemens, all these servo motor manufacturers generally make them in the same, a very similar type of rating, right? So they'll have 100 watts, 200 watts, 400 watts, 1.5 kilowatts, 2 kilowatts. The Newton meter and the RPM rating of all these will be the same, okay? So it doesn't matter if I'm using a Panasonic tool or if I am going to be using, Schneider Electric or Mitsubishi or any other tool like that. Okay, so let's try to select for this particular machine, right? Now this machine, as I said, has ball screws. Okay, so we are actually going to be selecting ball screws. So when I open this software, the first thing is selection of capacity we are doing now, right? So capacity of servo motor, and I can see certain options, right? So I have ball screw horizontal, ball screw vertical. Now ball screw horizontal is going to be used for my X and Y movement, and my vertical is going to be used for Z. Now why is this different here? Is because you need to understand when you're moving a servo against gravity and with gravity, it's a different story, okay? Here we are moving, we are only talking about horizontal, and for the Z axis is going to be vertical, right? There are also different types of mechanics used in the industry, like your ball screw with nut, okay? You also have conveyor, horizontal conveyors, vertical conveyors. You have your rack and pinion, right? You also have roller type selection. So these are all different types of loads, basically, right? These are the loads which we are going to be selecting. For our application, we need to select ball screw horizontal, okay? Just for your knowledge, if you need to select a coupling, reduction gear, gearing or timing belt, that option is also there, right? So let's select this ball screw horizontal here, and I'll just add it over here. And the moment I select it, I get some mechanical data, okay? Now this mechanical data is actually something which you will need to take from the mechanical ball screw data, the actual ball screw, right? So there will be some density, there will be the lead, the diameter, length, all these things will be there. Now, length is something which we can calculate. We can just take a tape and measure this machine and see how much length we have to travel, right? So let's say that the length is 500 millimeter, okay? And we need the mass of the table, which means how much are we moving? So this mass of the table will become this mass, right? This mass of this actual gantry and the other motors which are mounted over there. That also mass is going to be calculated. So let's say I'm moving 100 kg weight, okay? And transmission efficiency is generally the efficiency at which your power is going to be delivered to your ball screw. Let's assume this to be 90%, right? 0.9. And that's it, right? This is, I'm not changing the inertia. Obviously, if you're using your custom ball screw or something like that, you will have to change the inertia, right? So that is the first step in selection. After that, let's go to the running pattern, okay? This is something very important, right? When we are talking about running pattern, remember we drew this whole velocity graph and the trapezoid and all that, right? This is exactly what we are going to be deciding here. Now, you can do this in two. You can already know the velocity which you need to go, or you can go know the position. Now, in this case, I will know the position, right? Most of us will know the position. Why? Because we will know this is 100 millimeter, this is 500 millimeter, and I want to move that much of distance, right? So let's do a quick calculation, right? So let's say I want in the first second, sorry, this will have to change here. In the first second, I want to move a position of, let's say, 300 millimeters. Okay, and I have an acceleration time of, let's say, 0.1 seconds. Remember, we were doing that ramping, right? And I have an deceleration time of 0.1 seconds, right? So this, as you can see, this is a very clear trapezoid which has been used over here. And it's exactly what we had drawn over here, right? And this is why I had done the programming first before coming here, right? So we get this speed curve basically, right? Which is decided. And we can also tell it to come reverse as well, right? So we can say in the next 1 second, I want you to come to zero position again, right? And with again acceleration of 0.1, 0.1, and also deceleration time of 0.1, right? So now you can see this is the speed curve. We are going forward, we are going straight here, and we are going to go immediately, we are going to come reverse back, okay? So this is, in this application, we are actually going to go forward and come back here reverse, right? So we are just calculating for that, and we need to achieve this in 2 seconds, right? That is why we have written the time. So automatically your rotation speed has now updated here automatically by the software, because it knows that if you need to cover so and so millimeter with that kind of ball screw, then you will require so and so RPM, right? So anyway, this is your speed curve. Let's go to the selection of motor, and you can actually go here and select the motor. Okay, so we'll go here. Torque indication, I will say 100%. I want to see all, and I will say click on sizing. Okay, and this is actually going to size my motor for me, right? So just give it a bit of time. Okay, now as we can see that we have your selection happening here, and we can see immediately that at 100 watts it has failed. Okay, so this RMK actually means that it has failed in the inertia ratio, and it has also failed in the torque. So this torque is reaching 93% of the rated torque, which is a little bit of a danger for us, right? But our next best selection is 200 watts, which will be okay at all levels. So this is how we are going to select for that particular application. So now if we go to the running pattern, and if I increase this to, let's say, 1.5, okay, or 0.5, what is going to happen is that this is now going to fail everywhere. Okay, why? Because now this is going at 4500 RPM, which is too fast. Okay, there is no motor which is going to run at that speed. So if I now go and do sizing, right, this is going to show RMK, which is means out of range basically at every single wattage. So this is, I cannot use this servo basically, right? Let's go back here and put it back to normal. We are going in 1 second. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to increase the load. Okay, so instead of 100 kgs weight, right? So we were assuming this is 100 kgs. Let's say we are going to keep this at 1000 kgs. Okay, and let's see what happens, right? So we go again to selection, we do sizing. It is again going to take into consideration 1000 kgs and see which motor is going to be suitable for us, right? So you can see that none are suitable again, right? So 1000 kgs is way too much. So you will have to reduce this weight. So let's say 500 kgs we can try, right? So go to back to selection and click on sizing. Yeah. So this is basically your 100 watt, 50 watt, 200 watt and 400 watt all are out now. Okay, only your 750 watts and your 1 kilowatts is basically the ones which are allowed basically to run over here. Okay, now this is something if you also would like to see for the vertical, I could also show you the vertical point of view, because in this particular application we can if we have a 500 kg weight on this horizontal, then we will be able to select the 750 watt motor. So what clients generally do is that they, they would just select maybe a 1 kilowatt or something like that. And the price difference between these two is almost 20,000-30,000 rupees. Okay. So you can see that there is a loss of so much money because of the wrong selection, right? And this is why selection is so important, right? So let's try to select one more now. I'm going to delete this, right? And I'm going to put the vertical nut, right? Now in vertical, the rating is going to change probably a little bit. Your length of the ball screw will probably be less, around 300. And the mass of the table is going to be, let's say, around 300 again, we'll select. And the running pattern is going to be the same, right? Because we need to go down and pick something and come back up, right? A palletizer. So this is going to be your running pattern. And if we go to the selection, we'll just go through this. Yeah, and we see that none of them are coming. Okay, so now this is a little bit surprising, right? That why is the selection not coming? It was coming for our horizontal, right? And the reason is that you have to understand is that when you are picking up against gravity, you are also consider that amount of force which you are running against gravity. Okay, this is why you will have to probably reduce the weight over here, right? Or something like that, or do some modification mechanically in order to actually get your sizing to come correctly. So a lot of people actually design machines. They design, you know, maybe for college projects or something, they design robots. Palletizers is a very common thing to do as a BE project. They do not understand that they need to select first and then design the mechanics accordingly, right? So this is how you will come to know that you're mechanically you're fine, right? Because you already, so now I put a weight of 100 kgs, and in this selection we can see that 100 kgs, only for 100 kgs we have to take a 750 watt motor, which is for our horizontal it was coming only to 200 watts, right? So there's a big difference because of vertical load. So yes, so this is about selection of servo motors. This can be done even for robots as well. There are separate selection tools for robots. Okay, I would say it is easier to use those robot selection tools than to use this one. Okay, because in that you have pre-built templates where you can select whether it is a Delta or a SCARA or which type of robot exactly, and you know, accordingly then you will be able to select according to that, right? Okay, so that is it for the selection point of view. Okay, thanks a lot for having the patience and listening, and I will take a short 10 minutes 15 minutes Q&A round if anyone has any questions, and then I think we can conclude this session. So I'll just wait for any questions. Any questions, anything about this session, previous session or this session?
If any of the participants have any questions, then you can either post it in the chat window, or you can unmute yourself and just ask the question. You can just unmute yourself and just ask the question. If there are no more questions, then we can just wind up the session. Honorable Speaker Mr. Alistair De Silva, sir, and dear participants, for the last 2-3 hours, we were going through a very informative and fruitful session on robotics. I'm sure that each one of us has, each one of us was taken through various dimensions of PLCs, servo drives, and its programming. On behalf of the entire team, I take this opportunity to thank Mr. Alistair De Silva, sir, for being with us and enriching us with various practical aspects in robotics. Thank you so much, sir. It was a very effective and wonderful session.
Yep. Thank you very much to Vidya Academy, also to the electronics, electrical department. Thank you for inviting me. It was a pleasure being here.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
I thank each and every participant for joining with us, and we are very happy to learn together with all of you. Also, I thank the entire team of coordinators for the effort they have taken to bring this session fruitful in such an elegant way. And finally, thank you, AICTE, for providing us with such a wonderful opportunity for learning. Thank you all. Thank you once again. Afternoon session will start at sharp 2 o'clock. The afternoon session will be handled by Mr. Ramesh CR, Assistant Professor, Vidya Academy of Science and Technology, on the topic hands-on session on embedded system for robotics application. And if there is anyone left to mark your attendance, please fill the Google form, which is shared in the chat window. Okay. Thank you all. Thank you, sir, once again. Thank you.